Hi, welcome to Enchiridion. I am feeling great and happy to share with you these facts on Estemmenosuchus. Estemmenosuchus was a large early omnivorous therapsid. It is believed and interpreted to have lived during the middle part of the Middle Permian, around 267 million years ago. The two species, Estemmenosuchus uralensis and mirabilis, are characterized by distinctive horn-like structures which were probably used for intra-specific display. Both species of Estemmenosuchus are from the Perm or Cis-Urals region of Russia. Two other Estemmenosuchids, Anoplosuchus and Zopherosuchus, are now considered females of Estemmenosuchus uralensis. There was an array of complete and incomplete skeletons found together. Although other herbivorous therapsids like Styracocephalus also had head crests, Estemmenosuchus had by far the most elaborate head ornamentation of all of them. These crests varied between the two species, yet superficially, the head ornamentation resembled short deer antlers. The horns of Estemmenosuchus grew upwards from the frontal skull bones and appear to have primarily been display devices. As with many therapsids, the exact diet of Estemmenosuchus is still a subject of debate amongst paleontologists. Some have pointed to the sharp canines and incisors, and declared Estemmenosuchus to be a carnivore. Nonetheless, many of the herbivorous therapsids still support carnivore-like teeth, and the sheer bulk and size of the body suggests that it was shaped to incorporate a large digestive system. As a general rule, herbivores have bigger bodies to accommodate a longer and more complex digestive system, because plant matter takes longer to digest than animal meat. For this reason, most paleontologists consider Estemmenosuchus to be a herbivore, although some concede that it may have supplemented its plant diet with meat, and if this were true, then Estemmenosuchus would have been an omnivore. Another piece of evidence to support the herbivore theory is the orientation of the legs. The rear legs are situated directly under the hips, supporting the body weight from underneath. This would suggest that Estemmenosuchus spent a lot of time walking, as it would provide a more energy-efficient form of locomotion. However, the front legs sprawl out to the sides, similar to modern lizards. While this has been suggested to improve maneuvering, so that the head ornamentation is pointed towards a rival Estemmenosuchus, or even a potential predator, a more obvious benefit is that these legs would allow Estemmenosuchus to lift its forward upper body up and down, kind of like if it was doing push-ups. This pairing of different limb attachments would suit a herbivore better than a carnivore, because it would still allow for more efficient walking when Estemmenosuchus searched for suitable food, while also allowing Estemmenosuchus to lower its head to the ground for easier low-level browsing. The large size and bulk of Estemmenosuchus have also brought the suggestion that Estemmenosuchus was gigantothermic, meaning that the animal has a low surface area to body mass ratio, resulting in the outer tissue layers insulating the inner layers. This increases the base temperature of the animal, giving it a metabolism close to a warm-blooded creature, without the usual adaptations that would suggest that it was warm-blooded. Estemmenosuchus could reach a body length of more than 10 feet or 3 meters. Its skull was long and massive, up to 26 inches or a little bit more than 2 feet or 65 centimeters in length, and had several sets of large horns, somewhat similar to the antlers of a moose, growing upward and outward from the sides and top of the head. The animal had a sprawling posture, as indicated by analyzing its shoulder joints. The skull superficially resembles that of Styracocephalus, yet the horns are formed from different bones. In Estemmenosuchus, the horns are located on the frontals and protrude upward, whereas in Styracocephalus, the horns are formed by the tabular and extend aft. It has been suggested that the animal had a fairly constant internal temperature. Its large size and compact build gave a small surface-to-volume ratio and suggests it would not gain or lose temperature quickly. As we mentioned, this phenomenon is known as gigantothermy, and was probably an important factor in temperature regulation in most therapsids. Shedanoff reported skin impressions belonging to Estemmenosuchus in 1968. The skin was described as being glandular, like that of a hairless mammal or a frog. Estemmenosuchus means crowned crocodile. It was named by Shedanoff in 1960. It belonged to the kingdom Animalia, the phylum Chordata, the clade Therapsida, the suborder Dinocephalia, the family Estemmenosuchidae, the genus Estemmenosuchus, and the type species Estemmenosuchus uralensis. Species include the type species, Estemmenosuchus uralensis, and a second species, Estemmenosuchus mirabilis. Estemmenosuchus is interpreted to have lived some 267 million years ago. Two species have been identified from the ochre assemblage zone Belabay Formation at the Azovo locality near Akir in the Perm region of Russia in 1960. They were found with Baramosuchians Eotitanosuchus alsoni and Baramosuchus tenor in channel flood deposits of the young Ural Mountains. They had a different size, shape of the skull, and shape of the horns. Originally, all specimens were included in Estemmenosuchus uralensis, yet it has since been realized that there were a number of different species. Nonetheless, not all paleontologists agree that these were different species. According to Ibagnenko, in 1998, Anoplosuchus and Zopherosuchus are synonyms of Estemmenosuchus uralensis. Here is a graphic of the four species that may or may not be synonyms discovered in the location. It was a herbivore. Estemmenosuchus uralensis was about 14.7 or 15 feet or 4.5 meters long, while Estemmenosuchus mirabilis was about 9.8 or 10 feet or 3 meters long. It has been discovered in the Perm region in Russia. It lived during the Wardian of the Permian 267 million years ago. Fossil representation includes several specimens of complete and partial remains of individuals, including skin impressions. And with that, thank you so much for watching. I'm very excited about the new projects for this channel and learning more about prehistoric creatures and graphic design. Thank you to those that have corrected me and contributed to the accuracy of the information presented in the videos. I typically pin these insights as comments. I'm learning a lot with these suggestions, so thank you so much for them. As always, thank you for watching. This is Enchiridion. See you next time.